Thank you very much, Professor Animesh Biswas, Director of NIT Rourkela. Hope you are able to hear me. Is it clear? Yes. Professor Animesh Biswas, Director of NIT Rourkela, Chairman and members of Board of Governors of NIT Rourkela, Registrar Professor P.K. Das, Deans, HODs, and faculty members, administrative and technical staff members, Nitarans, my dear classmate and friend, Engineer Bharat Mahanty, invitees, and young students. Namaskar. At the outset, let me convey my warmest greetings on the occasion of the 74th Independence Day of India and 59th Foundation Day of NIT Rourkela. My heartiest congratulations to the various categories of awardees. Let me interrupt. I hope the voice is clear. Is it audible? No problem. Okay. I am humbled, honored, and grateful to be invited to deliver the first Professor Bhuvaneswar Behra Memorial Lecture, named after an outstanding engineer, dedicated administrator, institution builder par excellence, writer with natural instincts, and an admirable visionary leader. For me, I feel no recognition is greater than one from one's own alma mater. I am grateful to the director, Professor Animesh Behra, for his kind words about me. Dear Dean Madam, Professor Abhin Sahu, for patiently interacting with me via email to make all arrangements through Professor Vidyut Patra and Professor B.B. Sahu and others. My classmate and dear friend, Engineer Bharat Mahanty, for giving me moral support to venture to undertake this challenging task of delivering this prestigious talk within a very, very short notice of hardly 10 days. At my age and stage, let me take liberty of indulgence words about this great person, Professor Bhuvaneswar Behra, about whom I have penned down few words. It is not that I cannot talk extempore about him, but in order not to miss important points, I have put it down points about him. I'll quickly read out. Is that clear, Professor Vidyut? Yeah, because I am getting some echo this side. Okay. Professor Bhuvaneswar Behra, during early 1960s, had the undaunting courage to launch Deedan REC Rourkela from a modest ITI building that when he had no official approval for his own position and appointment and for the college. It was the strong patronage of the then Chief Minister Biju Patnaik which made Professor Behra to muster his indomitable courage to face the challenge and build the college from scratch, brick by brick. Those days, he had the forecast to rope in some of the best faculty members drawn from all over the country to maintain its national character. There were several excellent faculty members from Odisha, far too many to mention in this list, but he cautiously handpicked several others from across the country, such as Professor Kapoor, Professor Khanijo, Professor Sundar, Professor Dasgupta, Professor Subramaniam, Professor Umakant, Professor Nagabhushanaya, Professor Rangaswamy, Professor K.S. Dura, Professor Whittle, and several others. It's not that those from Odisha didn't contribute, But he had taken special care to get faculty members, those who were pursuing their master's and PhD elsewhere, those who belonged to different parts of the country. His greatest weakness was student community, whose welfare always he had in mind. Okay, he was always prepared to do anything for the students. He had a towering personality, terrifying at the first look, but he was like an egg appearing externally, a hard shell outside, but too soft inside. The way he adopted Mahatma Gandhi's non-violence principle to sit without food and water in front of the final year students' hostel and a circular cement platform encircling a tree stem melted the hearts of the final year students who were hell-bent on a procession, and the strike was called off. The faculty members too supported him in this peaceful dharana. When Rourkela Township was witnessing Hindu-Muslim wrath, he had the courage to give shelter and save the lives of few Muslims by giving them shelter in the campus, which was highly appreciated by the then Chief Minister Biju Babu. There are several such compassionate actions of him. When Dronarath got hit by a bullet in his thigh when the students were returning after a celebration somewhere in the township, at the middle of the night, he was worried. He was running from SP Rourkela to DIG Rourkela to IGH hospital to see how his life could be saved. At the end of a tiring and enjoyable day of celebration, when the students would chant, "Chuti," that means give us a holiday next day, for the next day, he would oblige them with his characteristic naughty smile. The entire NIT family owes its existence to this great engineer of our times, unfortunately less known outside Odisha. He was a father figure to all, a towering personality, and an illustrious son of the state, okay, with a very magnificent and majestic walk. He had a long stint of 10 years, to be precise, 12 February 1962 to 19 July 1971, a decade, before taking over at the Vice Chancellorship of the Sambalpur University and later then taking over as a member of the Union Public Service Commission. There are a lot of things to be mentioned about him. It has been an honor and privilege for me to be his student during his tenure of principalship. His autobiography called Call of the Village in English, which is translated from Odia, which is called Gaara Daka, translated by his son, Sri Vijay Kumar, the Binay Kumar Behra, IPS, who I am told has been the DIG, the DG of Odisha. And this book has been translated by him. Particularly chapter 12 is worth reading, which talks about his days in NIT Rourkela. Chapter 12 and the book are like Gita, Bible, Quran for every soul from NIT. True to Professor Behra's ideology, in this book, he is known as Buddhadev. I pay my rich tributes to this great soul on this occasion. Once again, thank you very much to the director, the deans, and other faculty members for inviting me to deliver this talk. As I said, this has been at a very short notice. I would beg your pardon if I do not do full justice to your expectations. So, as I said, he is tenured. It is always a pleasure and honor to talk about a great scholar, engineer, visionary, and writer. What I have tried to plan during the almost an hour's quick presentation is something like this. Engineering education being a topic close to the heart of Professor Bhuvaneshwar Behra, I took the liberty of connecting two seemingly dissimilar topics One on my own involvement in Indian higher education, and the second one on the recent disruption and transformation of higher education due to the pandemic. So I put on a few PPTs. As I said, in pursuit of excellence in my engineering education, starting from 1969, from the then Regional Engineering College, Rourkela, I had a traversal from that to IISc, Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. Then I went to Defence Institute of Advanced Technology as its Vice Chancellor. Currently, I am spending my time at National Institute of Advanced Studies. Okay. So let me quickly tell you how my journey has been over the steps, this strenuous and hard journey to achieve excellence in engineering education or higher education. As I said, I logged out from RECR, where I had, along with my friends, a very pleasant experience for 5 years, 64 to 69. Okay, it would have been an honor and pleasure to visit the campus on this occasion. The pandemic conspired against my strong desire to visit the place and personally offer my tributes to this great personality. After having left RECR, I got into Indian Institute of Science. I did my master's during 69 to 71, as was mentioned. And my bachelor's of engineering was electrical engineering, but my master's was in applied electronics and servo mechanism. Both the topics were fairly new from me, from college, coming from that college. And my master's supervisor was from Yale University, Dr. James Taylor, who subsequently went to the Analytical Sciences Corporation in USA. And he offered me a fellowship to Yale, to pursue my higher studies in Yale University. But I was determined, hell-bent, that I will not go abroad. Don't ask me why. I continued my stay all along to stay in India. I am out and out a homegrown product, except for short stints of giving invited talks, attending conferences. I have never had my formal education anywhere abroad. My bachelor's, master's, PhD, DSc, all are from India, particularly master's, PhD, DSc. DSc is an earned degree from IISc. It is not an honorary degree. And after my master's, I had a re-logging as an employee. I joined as a research assistant, teaching developing laboratories. I spent a long career there, 1971 to 2011. And if you quickly look at my involvement in higher education, technical education, research and development, which I have made in the first part of a brief few minutes of my talk, even in the title, I was in charge of developing a large number of PG laboratories, mostly using Russian equipment. You were wondering why Russian equipment. The Department of Computer Science and Automation, where I was working, those days was called School of Automation. It started with Russian collaboration. So we had got a lot of Russian equipments like analog computers, MN7s, process control instruments like different transducers to measure temperature, pressure, flow, humidity, etc. Typically for chemical process control and steel industries and all that thing. So I was in charge of directing, developing laboratories like Digital Systems Lab, Analog Computation Lab, Process Instrumentation Lab, large number of laboratories. Then subsequently after that, I took over charge of India's first hybrid computer center, AD511. Many of you might not have heard what is a hybrid computer. Those days we used to talk about analog computer. Analog computers are very fast. They can do real-time, faster than real-time simulation, because essentially they use analog computers, the components like the operational amplifiers. They're pretty fast, but then they have problems of error, accuracy, and it is difficult to program them, scale them and all. Where there is a combination of analog and digital, because analog will be fast, digital is supposed to be accurate. So people try to marry these two, called hybrid computers. So you can simulate the process dynamics, system dynamics, and the analog computer. And where you need accurate calculations of control algorithms, you can put in the digital computer and make them talk to A to B and D to A converter. Okay, these are two different breeds of computation. In fact, those days, the joke used to go among most of us that the analog and the digital being two different breeds, it is very difficult to establish a communication. It is as tough as initiating a dialogue between a newly married couple. And that was the first hybrid computer center in the country. No one knew how to program these things, how to debug programs, how to set up these things. I was in charge and I was involved, fortunately, in looking at the dynamics and control of SLV3 prestigious project, which was directed by Dr. Abdul Kalam. Okay. And he, along with Professor S. Dhawan, who is the director of IISc, who is a doyen in Indian space science, both of them used to visit the hybrid computer laboratories, and I used to spend late evenings and weekends and all where they used to sit, look at the simulations, where I've done a fair amount of work. As was mentioned, I obtained my PhD in the area of real-time chemical process control. This is something to do with ammonia process, Haber-Bosch process, fertilizers, chemicals. I didn't know ABCs of this thing. I had to read reaction kinetics, Arrhenius equation, how specific heat, the Cp, Cv, etc. change with the temperature, and what are the characteristics, talk about catalysts, reactions, heat exchangers. And I personally went to FACT Udyog Mandal in Kerala, spent time there, collected data, did the simulation, control, implemented to improve the yield of the fertilizer plant. So it was a real-time control application. And incidentally, I did even publish out of my PhD work in a leading chemical engineering journal called Chemical Engineering Science, which is quite popular among chemical engineers. Okay. Then I got involved in teaching. Subsequently, post-1980, after my PhD, I switched over to computer science, because up to that instant of time, control systems was quite familiar and popular in this country. But then the interest switched over towards computer science. There were hardly any master's and PhD programs in computer science and engineering in this country, except for undergraduate program in computer science in IIT Kanpur. Nowhere else, there were really serious computer science and engineering program. And Indian Institute of Science decided to get into master's and PhD programs in that area. I initiated large number of courses in computer architecture, graphics, database, number of courses on a sort of self-study mode, because as I said, I had never been abroad, picked up these things. It was a total transformation from control, process control, to computer science and engineering. And I was involved in consulting number of space, defense, atomic energy, and steel sectors to solve the challenging problems of real-time control. The Ministry of Human Resource Development, MHRD, at that time started the microprocessor applications laboratory to train teachers in microprocessors, 1885, 1886, some of these familiar processes. I was the convener to essentially impart, distribute kits, spread the culture of microprocessors and their applications in the country. And further down the line, I was involved in initiating a group of computational neuroscience at the institute, that is particularly an interdisciplinary group of biologists, computer science, electrical engineers, physicists, to look at the brain science activity. I was involved in some of the very challenging assignments in the initial stages of starting up some of the leading institutions in the country, CDAC, many of you would have heard. I served on its steering committee, governing council for a long number of years, which, as you know, with its headquarters in Pune, CDAC. And the National Brain Research Center, NBRC, was set up in Manesar, Gurgaon. Professor M. G. K. Venon, myself, Professor P. N. Trindan, Professor Dr. Manju Sharma, some of us were the initial society members to start this institute, signatories. For initial few years, I was involved with this institute. Similarly, IIIT Allahabad, from the formative stages, to later period for its recruitment, syllabi, number of those things. In Odisha, though I keep interacting with a large number of colleges for lectures, courses, seminars, conferences, primarily my interactions have been with Odisha Computer Application Center, OCAC, when Dr. Subhash Pani was at the helm of affairs. In fact, many of you may be surprised, Dr. Subhash Pani, myself, and some of us in the managing committee had thought over the concept of IIIT, which essentially was hijacked by the Department of Electronics at the time and the ministries. He is the one who gave this concept of IIITs. Then I was also a member of Science and Technology Advisory Committee to the CM Odisha during Sri Bij Patnaik, later Sri Janak Patnaik, several of the CMs. Okay. You have all heard about NEP, okay, our new educational policy. Prior to that, there was a committee called the famous Yashpal's Committee. You might have heard about Professor Yashpal, who was the former UGC chairman, a distinguished academician. I served in that committee as a member, whose charge was essentially to look at the rejuvenation of higher education. Okay? The committee came up with a number of recommendations. In fact, subsequent to that, there was a Subramanian Committee report. Now we have this Kasturi Rangan Committee report, several reports. So some of these features, the important feature of Higher Education Commission was mooted and reported there. Somewhere around 2008, I took over the Vice Chancellor, Defence Institute of Advanced Technology, which is university meant primarily for service officers, Army, Air Force, Navy, DRDO scientists, officers from Ordnance Factory, DGQA, and service officers from friendly foreign countries like Myanmar, Burma, Bhutan, Kazakhstan, several countries. They take their master's, PhD, short and long courses there. Every service officer, including even the chief of staff of Army, would have taken a course there at some stage or the other to pick up their rank. The chancellor of this university is the defense minister. I'm currently engaged in the studies in machine consciousness at the NIAS in Bangalore, which primarily deals with the study of the fundamental question of can machines be conscious like human beings. Okay? So it is an interdisciplinary group of physicists, mathematicians, computer scientists, social scientists looking at this thing, but far off from traditional engineering. I'm also serving a member of the governing body of there is a national mission on integrated cyber physical system. It's a large project covering something almost like 3,600 crores. Let me switch gears quickly, talk about higher education scenario in the country, what is happening and what are the challenges and problems. If one looked at the trends in engineering education, as you know, the intake, though, has been stipulated quite a good number, but the real enrollments have been coming down and the student pass are also the less. The interest over the years is declining. If you look at the placement scenario also, it is in a decreasing trend or the pattern. If one looks at the Indian higher education scenario, as you know, there is if you look at the 2018-19 survey of the higher education at the All India basis, about 993 universities, of which 385 are private, 142 are technical. We have at UG level 35.9% students in humanities, 16.5% in science, 13.5% in engineering and tech, 14.5% in commerce. At UG level, engineering and technology is fourth major stream with 38.52 lakhs students, with computer science and engineering having something like 8.8 lakh and mechanical 7.8 lakh, followed by electronics, other area. And in engineering tech, about 56.5% people opt for PhD after PG, and a good number have registered for PhD, and 8.3 lakh students have graduated in engineering tech. And PhD level outturn throughout has been something like 10,023 in science and engineering about 7,160. India produces a small number of PhDs compared to countries like China and the US. When China is going aggressively in producing a large number of PhDs. Recently, I was in Chinese Academy of Sciences talking to some scientists. I said, look, why are you producing so many PhDs? They said, look, we want to be something like Chinese Army as far as PhD is concerned. We want to produce large numbers. Even if some of them are of good quality, it is good enough for them. The total number of PhDs enrolled in India was 41,869, some in 1819 figure. And computer engineering had the highest number of students enrolled in PhD with about 58.7%. And if I look at the growth of engineering education, particularly PhDs, ACM, Association of Computing Machinery, did some survey way back up to 2015-16. The number of PhDs coming out in computer science and engineering is abysmally small, low. Okay, it is really one of concern. If you look at the research-focused institutions like IISc, IITs, NITs, in 2015-16, it was something like 174. Other institutions at 89, total summing to 263. They said in about 5 years' time, we will reach something like 405. Okay. There is acute faculty shortage, if you look at the statistics. It spread from something like 38% at that time to 53%, and IIT BHU right now the scenario is about 35-36% faculty shortage. Maybe IIT Goa being the topping the list with a reasonably high percentage. The reasons of faculty shortages, as you know, number of PhD registrants are not enough. Earning a PhD adds only few years to one's life without improving one's prospects for better pay. And according to estimates, the country's higher education sector, central, state, and private, is facing a shortfall of 5 lakh teachers, with about 6,600 posts vacant in central universities, 33%, and in IIT state universities, about 35%, and 38%, as you know, in state university. The and challenges faced by PhD program, as you know, is one of financial support. Students have always been craving for increase of fellowship or scholarship, lack of tie-up with right-up industries, better employment opportunities post-PhD, choice of a problem area, shortage of guides in specific areas like computer science and engineering, electronics in some of these areas, and elite institutions should concentrate on a PhD program. Okay. Is it clear in the voice? Yes. In fact, if you look at the PhD programs, there are also jokes you find. We talk about the Desi PhD, that means students going from the India to US, get into problems of financial support, discontinue in between. So there are all sorts of acronyms. PhD says, please hire desperate, probably headed downhill, patiently hoping for a degree. And PhD also means professor at Dogs, probably heavily in debt, pathetic homeless dog, a premature and horrible death. So a full-time PhD scholar, as you know, goes through a really very challenging period. If you look at the skill-based education, we always shout from rooftop that our engineers or technicians are not properly skilled. Only 7% engineering graduates are employable. What is wrong with India's engineers? Engineering students need to have hands-on training. India needs about 500 million skilled workers by 2022. And the silver lining is known. India is one of the youngest nations with 54% population below 25 years of age. So this demographic advantage can be used very nicely. There was a time when population, overpopulation, was a curse. Now it is a boon in disguise. Probably we will have a very large number of the young population who need to be focused, need to be trained properly. But then the question is, we do not provide skill training on the job. The percentage of workers receiving skill training is 96% in Korea, 80% in Japan, 75% in Germany, but is hardly 10% in India. The main problem with technical and engineering education seems to be the quality of intake. Decisions like allowing mere a pass percentage doesn't help. Many times we say, bring down the 60% requirement to further down 40, 35, 30, whatever it is. With the result, when we have this craze for more and more seats of admission to engineering, we have created a system where even after going to the last rank, we have problems even still filling up this one. The major concerns are quality of graduates, postgraduates. We have large number of PhDs, but then plagiarism seems to be rampant. We have paid journals. And the joke goes, today we have a scenario for every paper, every PhD thesis, for every paper you can find a journal to publish it. And for every PhD thesis, you can find three examiners who will pass the thesis. Okay, so the quality of PhDs is also coming down, particularly with the muslimming of private universities, deemed universities. Sometimes we call them doomed universities. Okay, it is really a pathetic scenario if you look at that, because PhD is required for a promotion to go further up in the ladder. There has been a craze somehow or other to get the degree. Quality of faculty, because once we don't have a good quality PhD, obviously this reflects on the quality of faculty. Lack of environment for creativity, innovation in institutions, and international participation is lacking both faculty and students. That's where we miss on global rankings, because they look for international participation. System is heavily oriented toward local textbooks in most of the engineering colleges, and there is no research culture in most of the undergraduate level institutions. They just do something for a job. Oftentimes, it is like duplicating or replicating projects, and transparent and proper recruitment and promotion policy should be there. I'm not talking about NIT Rourkela. If you cut across and see across the country, there are political interferences. And merit-based selection of director or vice-chancellor, the top person is essential. And autonomy with no bureaucratic interference is also something really a requirement of the day. And the curriculum has to be really innovative. There has to be a proper balance of science, technologies, humanities in the curriculum. That is something important which we don't do. You need social sciences, we know law, we know something about ethics. Today we talk about AI, machine learning. It has a lot of problems with ethics. What happens if a driverless car kills a pedestrian on the road? What law you use? What is the ethics you teach? And when you have some data, some algorithms which are used in AI and machine learning, how are you sure that they are not prejudiced against women, not prejudiced against blacks? Whether it is giving loans, selecting for a job, there are cases where there have been problems of this type of bias and prejudice. So students should be aware of these things. Character, tradition, national pride, ethics, culture, these are all important factors. And there has to be a manageable number of students, accreditation by national, international agencies. NEP has talked about one of the verticals for accreditation. And we have for international agencies like ABET and all. And research need to be interdisciplinary and industry relevant, because you, an electrical engineer, need to talk to a mechanical need to talk to a chemical need to talk to a computer scientist. In fact, if the work is interdisciplinary, chances are the more that the paper gets accepted and the project gets accepted, because there are always demand pressures in engineering colleges and institutions to get more projects, more funding, more of good quality papers being published. Faculty shortage to be addressed through adjunct faculty and online courses, either from the industry and all that thing. Online courses have been there for quite some time, but then the now post-pandemic, it has taken a new shape. Good quality publications in journals with impact factor given by Thomson writer and all important. There is no question of encouraging or considering paid journals, and never stop with conference papers. There is a conception in some certain group of people that if you just publish a conference paper, that is good enough. No, there are technical reports, next level conference, next level you talk about a journal publication. In an area like computer science and engineering, we have IEEE, ACM, Springer, Elsevier, they all publish large number of journals. The former president of ACM, Association of Computing Machinery, Mohsen Wadi, said, computer scientists should not stop with conference papers. Why are they not publishing in journals when there are so many journals? So when an institute is existing for 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 years, when a visiting committee comes, they would like to see how many IEEE transaction paper, how many ACM transaction paper, how many are ASME transaction paper, how many are from AICHG or Chemical Engineering Science or INDC development, or how many from Transaction of Institute of Metals, or some of these top quality journals, or American Society of Civil Engineers. One would look for this type of publications, even though there are few. Strong industry-academia interaction is important. Research collaboration, as I said, across multiple institutions, going outside the institutions. And there has to be a good ecosystem for innovation, startup, patents, and IP. There was a time when you used to say, publisher perish. Now, it is patent, publish, and prosper. Where you had to think in terms of patenting your ideas. PhD programs can be somewhere that introduced even starting from undergraduate level for very, very bright students at the end of third year undergraduate engineering. Those who have completed BTEC, maybe they take, those who have done third year BTEC, maybe another 5 years they take, get a PhD. So IIT should try to take something like 2,500 such youngsters. NITs and other places also can try to see how you can induct them. More teachers from other institutions in India joining for IITs and PhDs, and including NITs. Like 10,000 engineering institutions are there, more than that in this country. So we can have something like 2,500 such teachers every year for a PhD, instead of telling that we do not have quality faculty members with good PhD. So, and these should be supported by the present Ministry of Education. So government should support PG and PhD research in private institutions, because, you know, public-private partnership we talk about. US is some of the best private universities. We should also imbibe that culture, encourage that. After all, the private institutions have been supporting the technical and engineering education in a great way in this country. So collaborative private industry-based PG education should be started. There are many accrediting agencies, like we talk about DAC, NBA, and all that thing, but for international recognition can be considered. Recognize excellent teachers by awards. NIT Rourkela is doing a wonderful thing in the direction. And online courses like MOOC, MPTEL, Coursera, edX, and all the thing can be introduced through extensive use of ICT and stronger ties with the industry. And all these things, particularly good publications, projects, industry-academia collaboration, will give us higher ranking. If you look at the global ranking, there is always a cry that we do not appear in the first 100. If you look at the QS ranking 2020, none of the elite institutions even figure that, because this is overall problem in terms of international participation. Good quality publications, even if your publications, citations are not good, people look at the citations. So changing focus from traditional content transfer to nurture engineering thinking. Engineers must adopt fast-changing work environment, and the work environment has shifted to their workplaces, where you talk about virtual community places. And engineers should be ready to develop innovative products and processes, where traditional road of engineering is slowly going to technicians, because we have now moved from slide rule to calculator to PCs to wireless tops. So when you talk about the new context of higher education, it is driven by societal forces. You say it has to be self-reliant, socially relevant, sustainability, all these issues come, economic forces. Okay? It is cost-effective, competing in a flat world. The famous book of Thomas Friedman, you would have read, pressure to become a driver of high-end economic development, educating the workers in a world which, where everything is commoditized. The pressures are of a different nature on engineers, and the orientation is more and more towards practical orientation. Now, the Honorable Prime Minister says, make in India, Atmanirbharta, and all that thing. Technology, education, and leadership need a synergetic a network of technical institutions, and industry-oriented research is important. Sometimes university staff may find it hard to teach certain fast-changing topics of relevance. We need to depend on industry. When I say industry, university, it is applicable to IIT, NIT, some of these institutions. And engineering curricula lack significant content to enthuse young engineers to start business. That is where they do not get into startups, entrepreneurial skills, and all that thing that has to be increased. Technical or engineering education is becoming more and more internationalized, including higher education in all areas. Internationally competitive approach to education, creating bridges to cultures. One has to be aware of different cultures. Employees must be culturally aware, adapted different languages, laws, and legal systems. If you get a product, if you design something, you design a piece of software, how the law will essentially support or go against it in Europe or Australia, one has to be aware of these things. Exchange of teachers and training in industries and international level, as you said, the world is flat, by Thomas Friedman. Training has become modular. It is to be a lifelong learning process. In an era of internet, it is virtual study from workplace. Online courses will grow into the second important pillar or in a hybrid mode. We educate and train men and women who drive technology, but we do not teach them much about social, economic, and political context. Okay. Distinction between science and engineering is getting blurred, raising some serious issues of engineering education. People should know quite a bit of biology now, you know, with areas like neural networks, biological computing, some of these areas coming. I think knowledge of biology is important. So when you talk about quantum computing, a computer science electrical engineer has to know a little bit of quantum physics. Students are driven by passion, curiosity, engagement, and dreams. Universities must be made exciting, creative, adventurous, rigorous, and demanding, and empowering milieus. By university, I mean institutions. There is a globalization. If you look at the engineers of 2030, who they will be, what they will do, when they will do it, why they will do it, what this implies for engineering education. Must advance the frontiers of fundamental science and technology, interdisciplinary work that concern the most important problems facing the world. In the past, engineering education changed only when driven to do so. In present, it is a reactive posture putting engineering education at risk of rapid change. The premise is you have to now anticipate the future and shape engineering education in advance to create a significant dynamic role. Who knew that at this instant of time, due to pandemic, healthcare is going to be the uppermost? Now, everyone is getting into that. Mechanical engineers, computer scientists, electrical engineers talk about different types of things. How to develop control algorithms for ventilators, how to use AI machine learning algorithms for those things, how to talk about social distancing using image processing, all types of things. I have been also watching on OTV the wonderful work being done by NIT Rourkela faculty and students in this direction. My congratulations to them. So when you look at the attributes of engineer of 2020, the US National Academy of Engineering a few years back said the engineer, he or she, will aspire to have the ingenuity of Lillian Gilbreth, the problem-solving capability of Gordon Moore, the scientific insight of Einstein, creativity of Picasso, determination of Wright brothers, leadership of Bill Gates, the conscience of Roosevelt, the vision of Martin Luther King, the curiosity and wonder of our grandchildren. So the future engineer is something very different. Okay. So what is the expectation of today's engineers? Well-grounded in fundamentals, physical sciences and maths, knowledgeable about biological sciences. Capable problem solvers, innovators, and able to understand the role of customer needs in product design. And be cognizant of social trends and a grasp of environment, what is happening. Now let me very quickly switch gears, talk a little bit about the second part, where I said distance education, distance learning, particularly in the post-pandemic season. As I said, I have titled my talk in the second part is something like it's rejuvenation, different avatar in the refreshing form, okay, where the virtualization. If you look at the scenario of the higher education, in post-pandemic scenario, what happens is globally more than 200 million higher education students are unable to attend classes on the campus. Okay, large number of them. Approximately 70% of international students have returned to their home countries, while 30% stay abroad, many times facing significant challenges. Only 60% of teaching delivery has been transferred to remote online, which means 40% of students are experiencing significant learning deficits. Okay. But then this so-called lockdown should not be taken as a disadvantage. Great people have been under lockdown. You look at Nelson Mandela, who was in lockdown for 27 years. Okay. The president of South Africa, 94 to 99. Gandhiji, okay, who was arrested 13 times. Several of his work, what he wrote more than 50,000 pages. Several of these he wrote while he was in prison in a sort of lockdown mode. And in adverse situations, we had Ramanujan, who died at the age of 32. Even at his deathbed, he produced amazing mathematical theorems and new results. His work continues to inspire mathematicians till today. People are not able to understand the formulae, the implications, proofs, and all that thing. Marie Curie, Polish physicist, only woman scientist to have won Nobel Prize twice. Okay. And from exposure to radiation in the course of her scientific research, in the course of her radiological work at field hospitals during World War, she died at the age of 66. She had done wonderful work under adverse conditions. Albert Einstein, who failed to secure a teaching position, and he did his wonderful work when he was still a patent clerk. He didn't get a great professorial job anywhere. He did all his work of groundbreaking work papers in photoelectric effect, Brownian motion, special relativity. So the summary essentially is lockdown should not be taken in an adverse way. I think people can spend time effectively thanks to this digital learning, online learning, webinars and all that thing, be more productive. If you look at the quick transition during this period, the blue curve shows that the regular delivery over the past few weeks has come down drastically. And the fully online thing is increasing over the months. But we were not prepared. We simply had some emergency remote teaching. Okay, it is like an emergency scenario. Something was asked to be done immediately. People just immediately transformed themselves from regular offline or classroom teaching to suddenly something like synchronous teaching, digital learning. If you look at the outbound international mobile students, China gets the maximum number, as you can see, it is all peaking and increasing starting from 2000 to 2017. Next is India, next France, US, Brazil, UK, Japan, quarter. Why I am talking about this is this is going to affect international collaboration, mobility of international students. How do you face this challenge? If you look at the tertiary education, that is post-school, post-secondary, the education in colleges, vocational training, ITI type of institutions. If you look at Australia, yes, the largest number, something close to about 20-22%, followed by UK, Austria, Switzerland, and all that thing, okay? There was a survey conducted among students that which of these best describes how the coronavirus has changed your plans to study abroad. 63% said is defer the decision for the next year. 11% said study elsewhere. 10% said cancel study plans. 17% said something else. Something else means general uncertainty, weight and criteria like language testing, changing plans, online study, etc., etc. If you did a Google search of these two words, online and study words, during the past few months, you see study abroad word is coming down, but online is increasing at a rapid rate. If you looked at a country like Australia, where maximum number of students go, even from the, India, there has been a drop, fluctuating. Okay, same thing if you look at US, UK, and other countries, there has been a trend of fluctuating. It is like decreasing. There is a sharp increase sometime. It has not been very encouraging. Okay. This PPT essentially tells you higher education institutions, some 190 plus of them were surveyed very recently. They were asked undergraduate and graduate studies, what will there be a significant increase, slight increase, no change, slight decrease, significant decrease. For undergraduate, they said about 41% said slight decrease, 31% said significant decrease. Graduate, they said 33% will be slight decrease, 26% significant decrease. And if you looked at international students, there was a survey conducted by World Education Services. 67% said no impact on my interest to go abroad. 20% said I am less interested. 13% said I am more interested. Okay. So some of the lessons learned from this scenario is there is not enough planning or preparedness, okay, to how to tackle this scenario. We simply had a knee-jerk reaction and immediately transferred to this thing. A very fragile operational environment. Online education is easier to implement, but is not the panacea. Leadership in the time of crisis is needed. Many of the significant inadequacies of higher education system have become more explicit. Many assumptions are also being challenged now. So what you will find in the future, this will be new normal. Okay, you will find auditoria. Okay, you will find a restaurant. Okay, this young lady wants to celebrate with her fiancé, but then there is a separating glass door. Okay, so schools will be something like this. In fact, there was a cartoon and a board somewhere. It said, further down the line, after 5 years or 6 years, the school teacher, when calls, roll calls, will call the names like Lockdown Mahanti, okay, and Corona Samantharai, okay, and some of these type of names will be very this one, okay, like Quarantine Patnaik. And at the end of the roll calls, he will say, look, I am unhappy with you all. I admire what is called Atmanirbhar Sahu. Okay. So you will have a new university coming up. That is what we are finding. And this young person goes with his CV. And the interviewer asks, there is a gap in your resume. What were you doing in 2020? He says, I was washing my hands. Okay. That is what we have been talking about these days. There is a furious competition for talent. 720,000 onshore enrollment by 2025. That is from Australia. 450,000 international students by 2022 in Canada, China. Number of countries. They all will be trying to essentially pull international students. So the new reality, you have to look at with different lenses. The short-term implications are economic contraction, fewer revenues, higher dropout rates in schools, a few and none international students, zero rate student mobility, and possibly continuing teaching online. That will continue. Okay. And what are the consequences? Diminished enrollment of international students globally, multiplier effect on housing, travel, everything, varied financial staffing implications, risk of diminishing interest on international engagement through seminars, conferences, collaborations, visits, everything. So obviously, internationalization is not about attracting fee-paying students. Do students learn due to despite or independently of what we teach in the classroom? And are rankings important as we think? What is education about? Preparing people for jobs or for life and citizenry? These have to be addressed. So the options for considerations are, you should think of internationalization sitting at home through collaboration, distance mode of interaction and all that, virtual mobility, macro campuses, research collaboration, redesigning of academic programs. If you look at the scenario of a competing country, China, with India, starting from millions in different areas, no education, primary, secondary, tertiary, you see the plateau, which is both of us will be competing, and the scenario seems to be quite encouraging in the country like India. Okay, the shifting distribution of the global lack of people with the tertiary education, you compare the scenario from 2013 to 2030, you will the age group of 25 to 30, India will have something like 23% by 2030, and United States something like hardly 8%, China 27% compared to other countries. So you need a new type of leadership, action-oriented, but people-devoted, visionary but realistic, aspirational but inspirational, willing to take risks and challenge the traditional assumptions. You need to establish a strategic plan for internationalization, define adequate organizational structure, have incentives, and have good type of partnerships. And international curriculum is important, that the process of incorporating international, intercultural, and global dimensions into the content of curriculum so that the learning outcomes and assessments, tasks, teaching methods, and support, they can be properly supported. Okay. The critical role of the faculty is essentially they should own the curriculum as well as the promotion and the tenure criteria. Without the faculty motivated and activity involved, the curricular integration, if any, there is no chance of it happening. This is something very important that the faculty should be involved. More inclusive tertiary education institutions internationally and domestically, more globally engaged but locally committed informed tertiary education should be there, and institutions should be vocal for making the point about importance of internationalization. See, look at the pandemic scenario now. Every country is struggling with the same problem. The internationalization has helped in a big way. People are trying to look at common solutions, exchanging data. What is happening in a particular place, whether it's vaccine development, the therapies, there is collaboration. And this is one area where we have found recently maximum number of papers being published, different to do with that. Okay, due to lack of time, I'll skip some of these things. So now what happens in the future essentially one of unique momentum. So there are five challenges ahead. Contribute to an increasingly digital economy, leverage technology to deliver better and more inclusive education, then respond to growing demand by shifting demographies, and striking a balance between public and private provision, remaining global in an age of nationalism. Both are important. You will have to see that. Okay. So online university is something important that's internet-based, flexible. And you talk about experiential learning, traditional learning with hands-on work. Partnerships are important. And liberal arts, like which is interdisciplinary. So there is no magic formula for this. What may work in one case, it's not necessarily the best solution in some other cases. The word of caution is, for every complex problem, there is an answer that is clear and simple, but it's wrong. Okay. Governments must act, but national level changes are not sufficient. Higher education institutions need to embrace the change themselves. Are universities reacting, emulating, or they're proactively engaged in fostering this change? So it is like continuing doing the same, but you just wait for different results, which will not help. The paradox is higher educational institutions are the best laboratory for social change, but they have a tendency to inhibit their innovation capacity because there are some reservations. Okay. The higher education has to be more international, but more locally connected and socially responsive. Everything has to be satisfied. More flexible, innovative, more of entrepreneurship, more collaborative, and less risk averse. The problem is, the trouble with our times is that the future is not what it used to be. Okay, it is quite risky. I will just very quickly talk a little bit of AI, then stop. We have been talking recently about digital learning. Is any type of learning that is accompanied by technology or instructional practice? It is like deja vu all over again, because it is a familiar thing. We have been talking about that for the last few years, but then not in the current scenario of challenge. We have been doing in blended mode or once in a while, using edX, Coursera, MOOC, NPTEL, number of these things. But now the challenge has been different. Learning in a digital learning environment is characterized by the provision of learning materials. Okay. Students are increasingly engaging in their studies in a blended, flipped or online modes. This student says, are you ready to meet about the, there is a conversation, digital transformation. So, as you said, the reply says, we can't see your slides. Do you need to download the video plugin? From the other side, it says, no, we are restricted Internet Explorer. I try to email the slides, but it bounced back. This is our file limit is 1 MB. So use Dropbox, WeTransfer. It is the other side reply says blocked by our firewall. Google Docs, yeah, it can be, but it says I'm not sure how to present it. Maybe you can fax it. Finally, that is the answer. AI and machine learning is going to be used in a big way in experience and learning. Digital learning is impacting our educational context in different ways. There is a need to understand about AI ethical issues. I told you in the beginning, it should not be prejudiced. Ethics, privacy, security are important. We are doing a lot of transactions, a lot of transfer of information over the web, over the net. A lot of data about us, about others is being transferred. It might be misused. So today we are talking about a new area like big data, data science, data analytics, learning analytics. You collect all this data, talk about what is the problem with students, how it has to be analyzed properly, how they learn, what is the deficiency, how intelligent tutoring system has to be designed and developed, how from step to step based on the feedback one has to proceed. This is an important area of research. While many fear that AI in education means robot teachers, the reality is less dramatic but potentially transformative. There are three modes in which AI can be used. System-facing application, the tools that are designed to support institutions' administration. What is that administration? How the students use institutions' virtual learning environment. From this, you can get an idea about the risk of dropping out of courses. Student-facing applications of AI. What is it? Tools known as intelligent tutoring system. This presents students with some information related learning and often a quiz and test. We have dialogue-based tutoring system. Teacher-facing application. AI teaching assistant will give teachers smart access to relevant information to any subject and will help them manage a classroom. Tools are designed to support the teachers. There is an area which is coming up, what is called post-humanist perspectives. It is the idea of moving behind, viewing humans at the center of everything. Okay. That is, computers and robots are being used experimentally as a means of supporting learners. The Georgia Tech used an AI teaching assistant called Jill Watson. Jill Watson was introduced as a means of reducing the load of human teachers on a large number of easily answered questions. Jill took time to learn from interacting with students and offered some strange response initially, but ultimately it was trained to do almost like a human tutor, including even estimating how much time a program takes to execute. Okay. So what principles can help distinguish increasingly intelligent representational forms of teaching assistants? Does the work completed on behalf of or benefit of non-human instruments add to the knowledge? And when the student uses smart tools, what are its long-term effects on student learning process, education? These has to be analyzed. One of the important components in online is the laboratories. How do you do labs? An online lab is an interactive environment for creating and conducting experiments. The lab could be accessed through the web or as a program running a computer in the classroom. It should be simulation-based or it could be interactive. The aim is for students to experience the procedures of carrying out an experiment. The labs provide students with hands-on experience. There are many attempts. For example, in India, the IIT Delhi has joined hands with a few of the institutions. They have set up what is called virtual labs to conduct experiments virtually. You have Amrita and CDAC have done something else called Q-Labs. And like Internet of Things, today the Open System Labs talks about learning with an Internet of Laboratory Things. Okay. So online labs are like building simulations, like how to use a virtual microscope. The production of simulation software has been highly specialized. There is a need to ensure that learning designs for lab-based practical activities make the best use. One of the important aspects to be kept in mind in the present day is digital fatigue. We get tired looking at the screen, interacting with the experiments, listening to webinars, and interacting with experiments. One cannot do it beyond 4 to 5 hours per day. And it's also found that if you take X number of hours to prepare for a classroom teaching, you need probably 4 times X number of hours to teach effectively for digital or online teaching. Okay. Can digital learning preserve the teacher and student relationship? With high quality resources now freely available and an ability to acquire information, there is a need to refocus on the campus experience. The capacity to interact with qualified experts and see them model the process of applying knowledge is difficult to capture in a video. Digital simulation, virtual role plays, virtual reality environments are bridging this gap. But how much these will be effective, it is an open question. We will have to see whether it will be. There are many online tools like Google Classroom, Top Hat, Kahoot, Cisco WebEx, Pronto, Avaya, Zoom, and all that. Even we have seen when we were trying to set up this webinar in the morning, we had to sweat it out for almost 45 minutes to make it right. Technology has its glitches and problems. As we say, it is Murphy's Law which works most of the time. Open Engineering Lab provides practical lab-based teaching covering engineering, electronics, control, materials, robotics. Virtual labs. A group of 12 institutions and IIT Delhi has set up 100 virtual labs with 700 plus web-enabled experiments. These are simulation-based. You can do that or remote-triggered. You can reserve for these things. If they're remote-triggered, you can remotely trigger the experiment, but not many can work on a particular setup at any time. Simulation-based, maybe multiple people can work. Labster, popular in Europe and USA, GE Lab, LILA, that is Library of Labs, with 8 universities and 3 enterprises, OpenSTEM Labs, WebLab, Duestro. Platform like a Twitch is used for esports, for playing, entertainment, also for formal and informal learning. Guidelines for Ethics in Learning Analytics has been launched by International Council for Open and Distance Education. I said, a lot of data is being exchanged, starting from school children to higher education students. The data should not be misused by people. Security and privacy need to be addressed. For that, you have to use virtual private networks and secure cloud. The challenges are transitioning to online learning at a scale which is very difficult, complex. Highly motivated learners with good previous experience can use it very effectively. Organizing digital educational content to align with existing curricula can be critical. Making content available on a wide variety of devices like a mobile device is challenging. We have heard in this country, in school children, a school girl in Kerala had to commit suicide because her father could not buy her a TV or a mobile phone for online education. Okay, there are many instances, and we have watched even on OTV how people are selling, a lady sold an earring to buy a mobile for a child. These are really pathetic cases. Supporting the use of low bandwidth, including offline solutions, is effective. Staff teaching is also an important hour of the day. The Pan IIT survey was conducted to find out in India how online learning, digital learning has been effective. They sent a questionnaire to 840 instructors, 11,890 students with synchronous virtual classroom and asynchronous materials, two types, that is classroom and virtual. Mode of delivery, instructor feedback, you can see, if you go to instructor, only synchronous, 47% said, students said 20%. Only asynchronous, instructor said 14%. Students said 28%. Both more, blended. Instructors said 40%. Students said 55%. The general statistics is, even from places like IITs, only 62% students have access to laptops and desktop. Out of the remaining 38%, 33% have access to smartphones. Smartphones are challenging to complete assignments, projects, etc. because they are at home, far off areas. They are not in the campuses, villages, small towns. Only 20% students have stable and good quality internet. 80% students use 3G, 4G services that do non-stable. 1 hour of recording video can be something like 100 MB. Okay. The future scenarios, developments in emerging educational technologies are already significantly impacting education. It is clear that teachers will be working alongside AI and machine learning. The complex social environment of physical and virtual classroom will continue to raise issues and problems that will necessitate good amount of research and investigation involving social science, psychology, different areas. As has become apparent in the field of learning analytics, investigations cannot rely on technical solution alone, must be driven through fundamental understanding of how students learn. Things are happening at a dramatic rate in China. More students in colleges and universities, large number of PhDs are coming, many international levels of universities are coming. As I said, the goal, essentially, the state to become purchaser while the universities become the producer of educational services. State doesn't control the education. They are going in a massive manner to produce large number of the PhDs. We have seen today, you open a journal, you will find number of authors from China, guest editors, editorial board members, conference program chairs. They are invading S&T research like anything. One of the frontiers of engineering has to do with smaller and smarter spatial scales, like world of biotechnology, nanotechnology, information technology, future in cognitive science. The other frontiers with the larger systems are also important, like energy, environment, food, manufacturing, product development, logistics, communication. Engineer has to address at both the ends, micro and macro, both the ends, and keeping sustainability in mind. Engineering science is a revolution. We cannot be great engineering institutions if we don't have a great science. We should have physics, chemistry, maths, biology, everything. Okay. So that's why isolated institutions will do no good. We should have interaction with them, multidisciplinary type of work. Engineers must develop a sense of humanities and social sciences. Biologists and neuroscientists are also important. They talk about circuits, networks, mind, brain. Role of science and biology in R&D, security and anti-terrorism, like biological weapons, chemical weapons, you talk about. Sustainable development will be the agenda for the engineers. Engineers must be attracted to environment and sustainability. Pedagogy is important, like studio teaching, where we talk about experience in learning, engagement in research, like CDIO, popular acronym, conceive, design, implement, operate, should be the mantra. Information technology can send information outward beyond the campus, as we have seen, allow experiments to be run by the web. Openness will create a global meta-university. Larger percentage of engineers must earn PhDs, and there has been a 400% increase of PhDs in China. Must improve science and maths education in school, that is STEM education. You cannot simply do by changing engineering education, science, technology, engineering, maths. And unless these colleges are improved, something happens, you interact with them, nothing can be done. That is where even a place like NIT, Raukala, can interact with villages around, whether you talk about Jipani or something, some places around, to interact with people to see how we can improve their cause. IIT Mandi, IIT Gandhinagar have done wonderful work by adopting some villages and solving their problems, right from educating children to going up healthcare and some other things. Cognitive neuroscience will catch up with IT and give a deeper understanding of the nature of experiential learning, how they do. So 21st century science, when I mean science, engineering science in general, is multidisciplinary, multidimensional, information driven, international language. You do theory, analytics, experiment, simulation, lot of things, collaboration, okay. Growing proportion is collaborative effect, international challenges, it is digitally driven, and we do remote experiments and information systems, data analysis, data analytics, computational modeling, simulation will play a major role because you cannot build everything in the laboratory. Okay. The last point is about role of accreditation in global competitiveness, quality of higher education institution is the responsibility of institution. Quality assurance agencies contribute to this. We talk about institution as a whole being accredited. Program, as you know, institution as a whole, like NAC, program is an MBA. Meta-accreditation. What do you mean by meta-accreditation? Who will accredit the accrediting agency? MBA comes, NAC comes. Who will accredit them? You should accredit, somebody should accredit. International agencies said that. why I am raising accreditation issue here, all of us know about NBNI, outcome based, we talk about from rooftop. But the thing is, in the context of digital learning, in the context of online learning, how will outcome based learning change? What will happen to accreditation? What are the parameters? We were doing only for classroom teaching, some books, notes, you said this percentage, this is the objective, okay, for this course, this program and all that thing. This is how it was measured and assessed. Now, how will you measure it? How will you assess? How will you look at that thing? How the auditors will look at that? Okay, there are a lot of challenges when you have this type of even only digital mode, okay, synchronous, or if you talk about blended mode, how will accreditation change? They will assess the teachers, students, graduates, management, quality assessment, personnel, aspects of evaluation, the recruitment, qualification, performance, and all that. It can be within the country context, it's relevant. In a region like USA, Russia, Arabic countries, in a continent, internationally, like we talk about ABET and other things. There are four popular models of accreditation: minimal model, regulatory model, outcome-based model, peer review model, program club model. In India, we talk about outcome-based model. The other model, minimum regulatory, they primarily talk about there are certain minimum conditions to be satisfied, like regulatory, you must cover this much, minimum. You should have a minimum of this much of syllabus to be covered, this chapter to be covered, this concept to be covered, this case to be covered. Peer review program club model is a group of institutions form something like a club, a peer review model. They try to assess, they come together, you apply to them, they essentially do that. So in outcome-based model, small core and basic requirement has a basic parameters, like how do you maximize the number of graduates who continue medical law education, require evidence of measurement of goal. This is important in an outcome thing. Requires evidence of using the measurements to feed to improve the process. How do you do this for a digital learning process, for online learning process? That is what we said. We should look at concepts listening from the different side. The famous baseball legend from US, Yogi Berra, said, you can observe a lot by watching. Keep your eyes and ears open. Listen to instructions, suggestions from different directions. What our Rig Veda said, Ano Bhadra Kratavu Yantu Vishwata. Let noble thoughts come to us from every side. In fact, for students, teachers, and all that thing, the first verse of Valmiki Ramayana says, it is Swadhyaya, self-study, Niratam, consistent, tapas, effort. That is required when you talk about higher education in the present context at this one. Importance of questioning, need for experts, humility of a student. That is Bhagavad Gita says in chapter 4, verse 34, learn the truth by approaching a spiritual master. Inquire from him with reverence and render service unto him. Such an enlightened saint can impart knowledge unto you because he has seen the truth. So to quote Peter Drucker, he says, universities won't survive. Of course, you should take this comment with a pinch of salt. The future is outside the traditional classroom, outside the traditional campus. Universities need to gear up for this change. When I said universities, it is institutions in general, okay? Whether it's IIT, NIT, any higher level educational institution. This is what you are desperately looking for. To conclude, good teaching, research, and industry interaction are significant in improving quality and technical education. There are debates. Should PhD be enforced for good teaching? There are different views. Should I can be an excellent teacher? Should I do PhD? But then please remember, a good teacher has to be a good researcher, vice versa. A good researcher has to be a good teacher. You cannot be only one, okay? Adjunct faculty positions should be encouraged among institutions, industries, and R&D labs, even at international level. STEM education at school and college levels should be strengthened. Universities should have several disciplines such as basic science, humanities, law, medicine. Technical education institutions under universities should interact with these faculties, you know. IIT Kharagpur has started with the medical school now, medical faculty, they track with them. In the present pandemic scenario, you see mechanical engineers have been talking about this, electrical, electronics engineers, how do you try to pump in, okay? Air, when you talk about the lungs, there is an external system which is doing that, how it will synchronize, What type of control system you will use? Do you use AI and machine learning? Huge amount of data. Who needs the ventilator? Okay, who has to be quarantined? A doctor or a healthcare staff cannot be attending to all. There has to be an online system, okay? An AI or machine learning based system. It is interdisciplinary work involving healthcare professionals, mechanical engineers, computer scientists, electrical engineers, okay, electronics engineers, control system people. There are a lot of these things, okay? And if you talk about a device putting material somewhere, it is nano involving chemical engineers, materials, metallurgy, and all that stuff. This is what we should keep in mind. The future depends on what we do in the present, said, okay, the great M.K. Gandhi, okay? Because how we march from here, what steps we take, that is what will take us further. Thank you very much. That wraps up my time. I thank you for yours. Yes. Good. Nice. Thank you. Probably you don't have much time for questions. Thank you very much. If you want, you can just visit my website. There I have my Gmail address. You can shoot off questions, send some questions. Okay, no problem. Do you have any time for interaction, questions, anything? Does anybody have anything? All are online from. Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.